Welcome to BBC What's New from the Moon. Well, this is probably the closest I'll ever get to it. But this week, the world is celebrating the moment astronauts first set foot on the moon 50 years ago, when the American Space Agency, NASA, landed a crewed ship, the Apollo 11, there. It's considered one of the most important moments in history. But how much do you know about the moon landing? Here's Nasha with some facts and figures you might not know.
10, 9. Sequence start.
Apollo 11 launched from Cape Kennedy in Florida on the 16th of July, 1969. Six. It was a huge operation. 400,000 people worked on the Apollo 11 mission, and the average age of the flight controllers was just 27 years old. The lunar module, nicknamed the Eagle, reached the moon 4 days after liftoff on the 20th of July. The crew had practiced the final descent dozens of times, but the crucial moment almost didn't happen.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle Houston, you're go for landing, over.
Minutes before landing, communications with mission control back on Earth broke down. Neil Armstrong, the man who would soon become the first person to ever set foot on the moon, would have to do it on his own.
60 seconds.
By now, fuel was running low, and Armstrong had just 60 seconds to make the landing.
Four forward, drift into the right a little.
When he did, there were just 17 seconds worth of fuel left.
We copy you down, Eagle.
I'm gonna step off the limb.
An estimated 530 million people watched Armstrong's first steps, a huge moment in history.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Oh, that looks beautiful from radio.
He and fellow astronaut Buzz Aldrin spent 21 hours and 36 minutes on the moon in total. They were the first men to ever do so, and between 1969 and 1972, another 10 astronauts followed in their footprints. But no human being has walked on the moon since. And if you think about how much technology has advanced in that time, that makes their achievements even more incredible.
Oh, what an amazing achievement. Now, here's some other stories making headlines this week. First, to Sudan and the capital, Khartoum, where thousands of people marched to mark 40 days since dozens of pro-democracy campaigners were killed in June. The Sudanese paramilitary forces attacked a protest camp, reportedly killing at least 128 people, although authorities dispute the number. Demonstrators were commemorating the marches on the 40th day since their deaths, an important milestone in many cultures. Next, to Greece in Europe, where scientists have made a spooky discovery. They have found a human skull which is 210,000 years old. This means that early man, Homo sapiens, arrived in Europe much earlier than previously thought, 150,000 years earlier, according to experts. But some other scientists say they want more proof. And finally, some football all the way down in Australia. I'm sure, no doubt, you've seen many accidental goals, but this one by Paul Pogba is something. Painful goal. The Manchester United star was playing at a training session for their pre-season tour in Australia. Let's see that again. Ouch.
Yo, my name is Shoma Josie, aka the Black Cinderella, aka the captain of the Limpopo Champions League. You're watching BBC. What's new?
Now, you may remember a few months ago we talked about the youth strikes for climate, where young people around the world walked out from school to take a stand against climate change. Well, now, one teenager in Uganda is taking that further, and with the help of her dad, she's organizing weekly protests to demand change from her government. And it could be making a difference, as the Speaker of the Ugandan Parliament has offered her support. Let's meet Leah.
A rallying cry which can be heard on the streets of Kampala every Friday. Like thousands of students across the world, these young Ugandans have decided to go on strike once a week to protest against climate change. The young leader of these rallies is 14-year-old Leah. Her fight for the environment started in 2017 when heavy rain in Uganda triggered devastating landslides. Watching the scenes on the news, she realised that action had to be taken.
Right now, we are striking. We want climate awareness for the people. And we also want government attention. We are young people and we are fighting for our future. And we protest every Friday to fight for our future and the Mother Nature.
With her friends, Leah has asked the Ugandan government to be active in climate change in order to protect the planet. She hopes that Uganda will join other African nations like Kenya and Rwanda to try and reduce pollution by banning the use of plastic bags.
As we see here, people are dumping polythene bags, and our main issue of protesting is to tell the authority to stop producing the polythene bags that are affecting people's lives. I think people of my age are coming up to protest because they know they have the biggest stake in our future and they're trying to fight for it. I want the adults to realize that they also have a stake in the future. So let them stand up and fight for their kids' future.
Well done, Leah. Really inspiring. Now over to a daring wave rider who dreams of becoming Nigeria's best female surfer. This is 17-year-old Rachel Ola, who took on the challenge of learning to surf, and now she hopes more Nigerians will take up the sport.
Surfing has taught me to be very courageous and to be very consistent. I decided to start surfing out of curiosity, actually. Surfing sort of challenged me. And I love anything that tests me mentally and physically. So I think that's one of the reasons why I love surfing. Yeah, because the water always tests you every time. If you're someone that is scared a lot, you won't be able to get into the water to even paddle, let enough stand on the board. So you have to have that, you know, courage to be, you know, to just do it. I would love surfing to be more popular because aside from it being like a very good way of keeping fit, it's also a fun thing to do. I feel like it's also a mental exercise because, you know, you work with your body and your mind, and your all senses have to be open. Surfing is not even popular. So we can't get boards in Nigeria, we can't get things, we can't get leashes. So that's one of the challenges, because I had to order my board all the way from South Africa. All around the world, you see like really good female surfers and they're surfing the waves and they're really strong. But I know Nigeria is going to produce one very soon because we're smart like that. I'm going to be the number one professional female surfer. That's how passionate I am about it.
Now we all know that Africa is home to some of the most vibrant cities in the world, and we've been asking some of you to show us your favorite things to do in your hometowns. This week, 13-year-old Langlihle invited us to the capital of eSwatini, Mbabane. Check it out.
My name is Langlihle. I'm 13 years old and this is my city, Mbabane.
Mbabane is the capital city of eSwatini, a country located in the southern eastern Africa. The country has a population of 1 million people. Mbabane just has 100,000 people. Mbabane city was named after Chief Mbabane Kunene, who lived in the area when British settlers arrived. The city is known as a major tourist destination. Let me take you around. Like many cities in the world, Mbabane is comprised of many buildings. Most of them are government offices.
This is the Mbabane market, one of the busiest markets in the city. You can buy clothes and food.
It is famous for selling traditional artifacts and attires. Most of them are made using the national flag. And I couldn't wait to get one for myself. Mandenga village in eZulwini is just 2 kilometers from Mbabane city. It is a typical Swazi homestead portraying the lifestyle of the Swazi people a century ago. Visitors are welcomed with song and dance from traditional dancers of the Swazi community.
This is Sibebe Rock. It is one of the best tourist attractions here in Mbabane.
The rock that is found north of Mbabane is one of the Southern Africa's most impressive geological features. Most tourists come to eSwatini just to climb the rock and observe other features around it, like beautiful trees and rivers. Just outside the city, you will also find Bushman paintings. These paintings are seen on the cave walls of eSwatini and remind us of our heritage. The museum contains the reminders of Swazi years-old traditional values and culture. Traditional clothes, necklaces and beads used by the people in the past are also kept here. eSwatini is known for being rich in culture. This means there is plenty of traditional food. My favorite meal is traditional chicken and I find it right here at eSwatini restaurant. King Sobhuza II Memorial Park was built as a tribute to King Sobhuza, who led the country to independence from the British without bloodshed. I hope you get time to visit Mbabane, the city with the real experience.
Thank you, Langilihle. Now, let's talk about vaccines. They are a really important medical tool which save millions of lives every year by preventing serious diseases from cervical cancer to measles and polio. The World Health Organization says global vaccination coverage has stayed around 85% for the last few years. Now, this might sound good, but if that number improved, another 1.5 million deaths could be avoided each year. It's estimated that in 2017, nearly 20 million infants worldwide weren't given routine vaccinations, and five of the worst 10 performing countries for vaccination rates amongst children are in Africa. But do you know about how they actually work? Let's find out.
Today, the vast majority of us have been vaccinated, nearly 9 out of 10 of us. But because a few of us haven't, this makes a difference. It means there are more outbreaks of diseases like measles all over the world. Let's take a look at why. Our bodies are designed to protect us. When a nasty disease comes along, our immune system creates lots of little antibodies to fight it. It takes the body a bit of time to work out which one will put up the best fight. Once they've done their thing, they're ready and waiting to do it again, should that disease come back. So when we're vaccinated, we deliberately put a weaker or dead form of a disease into our bodies that can't make us sick. So our bodies know how to fight that disease should we encounter it again. Now, let's talk about herd immunity. It's how a community, especially vulnerable people who can't be vaccinated themselves, are protected. This lot are vaccinated and can't get certain diseases. But this one isn't, but because he's surrounded by the herd, diseases can't get to him. Herd immunity. If the majority of a community are immune, disease cannot spread. But aren't some people worried about being vaccinated? And what about those who can't access vaccines? Or those who, for religious or cultural reasons, don't want to vaccinate their children? Here's the problem. For herd immunity to work, a a certain percentage of the population needs to be vaccinated. The moment we dip below that percentage, we can't rely on the herd to protect us. So those most at risk, like young babies, the elderly, and those with existing health conditions, could get infected. But the bigger and more immune our herd gets, the more protected we all are against very serious diseases. Pretty cool, right?
Now some sport, not football this time, cricket. But as you can see, this isn't just any cricket. It's the last man standing Rhino Cup, and the tournament is as interesting as its name suggests. It's held in Kenya every year to raise awareness of endangered species, and it's played right in the middle of a wildlife park surrounded by animals. Celestine from BBC Sport Africa has been to see why it's not as risky as it sounds.
I've played cricket in a lot of places around the world, but this definitely tops the list.
At first glance, there's nothing odd about this cricket game. Batsmen, bowlers, stumps, field dimensions. But take a closer look. The location is one of a kind. Here, players keep one eye on the ball and the other on elephants, lions, and other wild animals.
When the ball is hit towards where the animals are, you have to think before you run for the ball, first of all.
For 5 years, teams have come to the Olpejeta Wildlife Conservancy in central Kenya, not for a safari, but the ultimate cricket game.
When I first came here for this year's tournament, there was just so much wildlife all around here. Big herds of buffalo, which, as you know, the most dangerous animal in Africa, and does really delay proceedings.
Cricket is not a very popular game in Kenya, and bringing a tournament to the middle of a wildlife reserve might put many people off. The idea that a pride of lions, a herd of elephants could lead to the stoppage of a game could be a bit frightening for some. But to those who come here, it has its own allure.
It is my first time to come here, and I have had a lot of fun. I was an umpire, and even when it wasn't time for me to umpire, I'd request to switch with someone else so that I'm always in the midst of the action.
But this match is about more than just attracting new fans and tourists to the sport. The Olpejeta Conservancy was home to the last surviving male northern white rhino who died last year. This tournament is to help combat rhino poaching by fundraising for the protection of the species, which can be quite costly.
The security cost per rhino is about $800 a year, and there's over 150 rhinos here.
The tournament has helped raise over $100,000 towards charity projects, including rhino conservation. One of the regular local teams at the last male standing Rhino Cup is a development side, the Obuya Cricket Academy.
It helps the development side because right now we are looking at the future of Kenyan cricket in the next 5 years. And as you can look, most of the teams playing here are development sides between the ages of 8 years and 20 years.
Nairobi-based Canby's Sports Club won the title this year, but the biggest winners of this tournament are its local residents, who may not care much about the games, but are its biggest beneficiaries.
Good cause, but I think I'd be scared. Now, she's one of the most sought-after female artists in Ghana. Easy, aka First Lady, has won awards and nominations that have led her to hosting one of the most popular music shows in West Africa, the Ghana Music Awards. Yvette went to meet her during her world media tour to find out what the challenges are for female artists today.
You might know her through this hit. And this one. Or even this one. Whatever Easy puts her hands on, it just makes people dance.
I started music in 2009. First single was Bonsem Mommy. Yes, under Richie. He had a small label that he was putting together at that time. So I was the fresh new spirit there. And the vibe was amazing. I got in the studios, we wrote the first song, Bonsem Mommy, and pow.
Yeah.
In 2012, Easy left her debut record label.
Can you tell us more about the breakup?
It was a mutual breakup. You know, it always says you shouldn't forget your roots and where you come from. And so I give them massive respect for helping me to find my feet, you know, as an artist.
Beside music, she's also a graduate in marketing. And she's using that to also make money.
So I do business planning, business marketing. I'm into real estate as well back at home. So I like to add it up to music as well, just to make some extra bucks.
So in your opinion, what are the challenges that female artists face today to stay on top?
It's very tough to break through. And when you do, the hardest point is actually keeping your relevance. And so challenges such as timing, biological clock, because you're growing, and it gets to a point where you're thinking, okay, do I have kids now? Do I get married now? Or do I still pursue my passion? Being accepted by both sides is really hard, but in all, I think that so long as you have the passion inside you and you're confident, determined, you will break through.
I see the fire burning in your eyes. You keep hurting me, but I keep putting aside.
But to follow your dreams, it also means taking chances.
The first sacrifice was the first 3 years straight. I had to put marketing and what I graduated in the book. It was a very tough decision for me because I was walking into an industry where I didn't know what would come out of it. I didn't know the turnout. Because people always feel like, oh, with females, they don't last long. You know, a year, two, three, that's it, your shine is gone. And for me, the determination is always to keep going every single time, every single year. You know, I've had great times and I've had, you know, down moments. I've had times when my songs have been great and times when I'm like, what is going on? But you've got to be very patient as a woman. You've got to understand that your fan base will grow along with you. And so as you grow, the type of music or the composition of music has to be changed.
She has worked with some of the most influential musicians in Africa, like Shatta Wale, Mr. Easy, and has recently released her EP titled Solo, featuring Medico from Ghana.
If you could go back in time, mm-hmm. What would be the best advice that you give to your younger self?
There was one embarrassing moment I had on stage where I fell on stage performing live on TV, Ghana Music Awards nominees jam, to a crowd of about 3,000 people. And if I had one advice to give to my old self, it would be go with sneakers, not with the heels.
Oh yeah, we'll be avoiding those high heels on stage. That's all from the BBC What's New team this week, and see you next time. Bye.